The opportunities are dwindling for Met fans to hop the 7 train and head on out to Citi Field. Some folks are making their way out to the ballpark for the first time, just learning their way around. It's always a good time to catch your first baseball game, and tonight, it's the Mets and the Nats. At Citi Field in New York, the New York Mets play the Washington Nationals. Mets baseball is presented in HD by IOTV. Get the best in HD free with IOTV. And a pleasant good evening, everybody, and welcome to Citi Field. I'm Gary Cohen. Keith Hernandez and Ron Darling join me in just a moment as the Mets play game 3 of their 4-game series against the Washington Nationals. The Nats have taken the first two, each by a 3-2 score, and the Mets have lost 4 in a row, 6 of 7 on this homestand. Jose Reyes has been hitting. In fact, he leads the National League in hitting and had 3 hits last night. But Reyes continues to be limited. Last night had a couple of stolen base opportunities, did not steal the base, and said after the game that he is feeling okay to play, not feeling okay to run. And Keith, I guess the question is, where do you draw the line when you're Reyes about when to go hard and when to let up?
Well, my feeling is Reyes should just shut down any base stealing, any attempt to even think about base stealing. You know, you're playing for third place, okay, fine. And you got the Nationals are hot on their trail. They're 1 game behind them. But to me, right now, Jose's health is the issue going forward. If you're going to have him back, you don't want him to re-injure the leg. And let's face it, come on, he's going to make Met history. He has a great chance to make Met history, and that's when a National League batting crown, and he needs to stay healthy and swing the bat.
Has a 4-point lead in that race going into tonight. Mike Pelfrey will be on the mound, and Pelfrey still looking for that level of consistency heading toward the end of the season.
You know, it's been a lot better. You know, he had that personal catcher, Ronnie Paulino, throughout the middle of the season, and now Josh Tolley is back catching Pelf. Really good start in his last start. You see the numbers reached got into the seventh inning, and Pelf was using all of his pitches, and he's going to need them all tonight, because going up against the Nationals, Brad Peacock is one of their pieces for the future. They have Strasburg back. Brad Peacock was 15-3 in the minor leagues this season. He's outstanding. He is the next on the list behind Strasburg as they try to rejuvenate that team in Washington.
So it's the Mets and Nats tonight. Pelfrey against Peacock as the Mets look to put a break on their 4-game losing streak, hoping the sun will shine on the Mets tonight. Mets and Nats, all the action coming up right here on SNY. TV. Get the best in HD free with IOTV. By Parts Authority, the only name in auto parts you'll ever need to know. Visit them at PartsAuthority.com and become a VIP member today. By Hyundai, people are talking about Hyundai Uncensored. See what they're saying at Hyundai.com. By Citi, by Lexus, and by Lowe's. Follow the Mets with the MLB.com at Bat 11 app for your iPhone, iPad, Android, or BlackBerry. Check in using at Bat at Citi Field to receive special offers. Text at Bat to 31826 or visit Mets.com for details. Here's your Mets upcoming schedule. Remember, all Mets games on SNY are available in HD, presented by IOTV. And you can listen to every Mets game on Sports Radio 66 WFAN. Day game tomorrow to wrap up the homestand. Then the Mets' final road trip takes them to Atlanta over the weekend and St. Louis next week. Those two teams battling for the National League wild card. Then the Phillies, who clinched a playoff berth today, and the Reds are in for the final homestand of the year. Mike Pelfrey making his way in from the bullpen, getting ready for his 31st start of the season. Fans making their way in. First pitch coming up. By Ford. Ryan Zimmerman had the go-ahead hit last night. Rick Ankiel has been killing the Mets with his bat and his arm all year. Josh Tolley, watch out. He's thrown him out of the plate twice in the last 3 weeks. The Nats trying to make it four straight over the Mets, and Mike Pelfrey on the mound facing the Nats for the second time in 10 days.
Well, in his last start, that was his 30th, fourth straight season that Mike Pelfrey has reached that 30 game started or more plateau. You can see the number 7 wins this season, 96 strikeouts, 20 home runs, although he went a long stretch after giving up number 19 before hitting number 20.
And the Lexus Mets defense. Mr. Satin played 20 games at first. This is his second start since his call-up. He's been pinch hitting a little bit here and there, so he gets another chance to get 4 at-bats. That's always very exciting for a young player.
Well, Terry Collins' team was officially mathematically eliminated from postseason contention today once the Braves beat the Marlins this afternoon. And Terry said, look, you know, we're realistic enough to know we were out of it a long time ago. It changes nothing. We still have to play hard every day. That's what we do.
He said the only disappointment is that he felt when they left Port St. Lucie, they had a good ball club, and they just could not keep it together with the injuries.
Ian Desmond will lead things off for the Nationals. Desmond 2-for-7 in the series, hitting a .245 on the year. He's been doing a little better since Davey Johnson moved him up to the leadoff spot the last month. But overall, not the kind of season that the Nationals were hoping for from Desmond. An on-base percentage just .290, 128 strikeouts. Leading National League shortstops in errors.
And he shouldn't strike out that much. He's not a power hitter. But, you know, it's a trend. A lot of guys striking out today.
It's an open question, I think, in Washington, whether Desmond is their long-term answer at shortstop. In fact, there are a lot of people with the Nats, as Desmond fouls it back, who believe that Danny Espinosa, the second baseman, is a better shortstop than Desmond is.
Well, I think a lot of it depends on who they have coming up that are middle infielders in their farm system, and also Desmond's a young shortstop. I'm sure there'll be teams out there would take a chance on him.
Alfrey ahead 0-2. And Desmond takes inside. But it also raises a very interesting question whether the Nationals might decide to be a player for Jose Reyes if Reyes does not re-sign with the Mets. Here's the 1-2. A little broken bat liner into center field and a base hit for Desmond to open the game. I mean, there are certain teams you know are going to be in the Reyes sweepstakes, right? The Giants, Red Sox, maybe even the Phillies, since Jimmy Rollins is a free agent at the end of the year. But would the Nationals be interested as well?
Well, one thing about the Nationals last season is that they made a bid on Cliff Lee. So you know that, you know, they gave all that money to Jason Worth. So they were players last winter. Why shouldn't they be this year?
Here's Rick Ankiel. I mean, there's been so much conversation about the Nationals potentially being a landing point for Prince Fielder. But, you know, the Nationals have Adam LaRoche under contract for next year. I think they owe him $8 or $9 million, and he's coming back from labrum surgery. Should be healthy next year, so maybe Fielder isn't the best fit if they wanted to go make a big splash.
Except those players like Reyes and Fielder, you only have one shot at them, Gary, you know? And who knows what the number is going to be for Fielder. I think that Reyes is going to be offered something substantial. I'm not sure about Fielder.
And Keel riding an 8-game hitting streak, 3-for-9 in this series, and Belfry throws a fastball by him.
Another thing, too, is the players, you know, it's your option year, and you can pick and choose. And I think even after 6 years in the big leagues, you're going to want to, those players on the free agent market want to go to a winner. So I think it kind of handicaps Washington.
I think the real good players want to go to a winner, but sometimes you have those free agents, Keith, like a Worth, that this is their one chance to cash in.
And some guys can pick and choose better than others.
Yeah.
You know, when Greg Maddux turned down more money from the Yankees to go to the Braves, he knew he was going to the right spot, even though he didn't take the top dollar. And it wasn't necessarily because the Braves were winners at that point, although they had begun that process of becoming a perennial powerhouse, but because, you know, that was the environment he wanted to be in. Desmond takes off, the throw by Tolley on a hop, not in time. And Desmond has his 23rd stolen base of the year.
Well, 23 stolen bases, caught 10 times. And Mike, they've been stealing off Mike this year. Slow home. And he steals that either. That's a great angle.
You know, his last start, he had the wherewithal when he was pitching to give that little slide step about a half a dozen times. Kept him closer, but this time not, no slide step and a big jump.
And he didn't come to a stop very much, and Desmond was kind of in that mode where he was kind of in moving, his momentum was carrying the second base. He didn't freeze him.
It's 9 straight starts now that Pelfrey's given up at least one stolen base. He's been so vulnerable to the stolen base all year. 3-2 now to Ankiel, who swung through that 3-1 fastball. And it's inside, ball 4. And so Pelfrey, who had to throw 30 pitches to get out of the first inning in his last start, allows the first two men to reach. You see, the stolen base was not a big problem for Pelphrey in past years, but this year it's exploded on him.
And don't forget, some of those early years, he was having more contact on the ground with guys on first. The end result is he had those 28 and 29 double play balls that have not been the result this season.
So now he faces Ryan Zimmerman with two men on. Zimmerman 3-for-9 in the series at the go-ahead hit against Bobby Parnell last night in the seventh inning, hitting a 292 for the year. First pitch grounded right to Reyes. Can they turn two? Tejada gets rid of it and on target as he got run into by Ankiel and completed the double play. Great job by Tejada. Two out.
Well, last night Reyes opted to, if you recall, to run to the bag on Tegan himself. This time he gives it to Tejada, who gets clobbered but does a nice job turning.
And a nice pick by Satin at first base, a new position for him. He's been a second baseman most of his career.
That was lucky for Tejada. His front foot was stationary when Ankiel slid into that front foot.
You want to get elevated there, right?
Well, you want it at least loose enough so it can kick under you.
So now two out, Desmond at third, and here's Michael Morris. 1-for-8 in this series. Seventh in the National League in batting average at 307. Let's look at that play at second again.
Watch his left foot, Tejada's, Keith.
Very nice. And that's almost a play there where Reyes could have taken it by himself. You know, but he opted to flip it and he gets taken out. He really could have got clobbered. That,
yeah,
that was Hal McCray. He'd have had him in left field.
But I see what you're saying, Ronnie. You know, that was very close because that foot was planted and he just kind of got it up a little bit before Anko got there. Otherwise, that's his knee.
Yeah, that's a hyperextended problem right there. Good. But nothing happened.
One and one to Morris with Desmond at third and two out. You know, we were talking about the chances of the Nationals going after Reyes, going after Fielder. It's fascinating when you look at potential free agents. The market for them often depends on who else is out there and, you know, what the need is of more teams. Because, you know, Fielder and Pujols are both going to be free agents, and most of the richer teams have established first basemen. Whether it's, you know, to share with the Yankees or Gonzalez with the Red Sox, etc. Whereas there's such a great, maybe a greater need for a guy like Reyes, who brings those skills to bear on at the shortstop position.
Reyes is going to have lots of people interested in him, no question. And big money teams that can afford to pay him.
Morris goes down on strikes and Pelphrey gets himself through the first inning thanks to the double play ball and the fine play by Tejada. Mets come to bat in the bottom of the first with no score. Tonight, Josh Sutton gets his second major league start. Jose Reyes leading the National League in batting. 4-point lead over Ryan Braun starting play tonight. Jason Bay back in there after sitting out last night with a sore shoulder. Reyes had three hits in last night's game. Takes a strike from Brad Peacock, making his first major league start.
Well, it was outstanding. See those numbers. It was 9 starts in Double A, 14 in Triple A. He was the pitcher of the year in the Eastern League.
Good walk ratio to innings pitched and strikeouts more than innings pitched.
Real success story here. 40 first round pick.
And this was a real breakout year for Peacock. He had not enjoyed a whole lot of minor league success before this year. In fact, they were a little undecided whether he was going to be a starter or a reliever. His minor league career before this season, 19-35 with a 4.44 ERA. But this year, splendid at both Double A and Triple A.
Geez, hello, ump.
And you see Peacock, he can throw hard.
Yes,
and he's only 6'1", 175.
Well, a lot of people I've talked to, he reminds the stature of a David Cone with a Mussina knuckle curveball.
2-2 to Reyes, and he pops one up. Coming back is Flores. And just enough room to make the basket catch, sort of.
That was a little unorthodox. And we'll do the Coors Light Nationals defense, as we do every game for your folks' entertainment. Flores gets his 18th start of the season. Marrero has been the guy, the young guy at first base. They're giving him a shot.
You know, there are a lot of broadcasts, and they all show the defense. But the only broadcast on which the defense is entertaining, just showing the defense, is ours. And there's a reason for that. Here's Ruben Tejada, 2-for-5 last night. He takes a strike.
Well, you know, folks, the things that we do every night, we always bring you the lineup. We bring you the starting pitcher and his stats. And, of course, the defense, you know, you kind of have a little fun with it. You know, it's 162. I know our Mr. Picker in the truck tries to embellish as much as he can. He's very creative, but there's only certain things you can do with, you know, the defense.
Yeah.
Did you say 162?
Well, 105 for me.
1-1 to Tejada, and he slugs one to center field. And Ankiel drifting back to out. See more with that with Tejada lately. Just trying to muscle up a little bit.
It almost seems like the bat starts to swing him, Gary. Mentioned that, remember last week on the road trip, and I kind of threw out the idea that maybe go down a half an ounce. If that bat starts swinging you, you know, a lot of times guys I played with over my career, the last 2 months of the season was August, they went down a half an ounce.
So two out of nobody on. Here's Lucas Duda, 3-for-8 in the series. And three hits last night and drove in a run.
Oh, I like this kid the way he throws right now, Ron. He throws hard, not afraid to throw his fastball.
Peacock made one relief outing for the Nationals. That was 8 days ago. They put him in against the Dodgers, and he gave up a run on 4 hits in an inning of the third.
In fact, that was the Steven Strasburg first start, and he came in first batter, Matt Kemp.
Welcome to the big leagues, kid. Duda pops it up. Desmond out. Morris in. And Morris will take it. Side retired. So Peacock gets through his first inning unscathed. Mets go 1-2-3. No score after one. Bobby Ojeda during the third inning of tonight's game, just go to SNY.TV. Click on the link and join the conversation. It's Chat Live with Bob Ojeda, presented by Verizon, only on SNY.TV. And I have to ask you guys, every time we put up the graphic with Bobby O's name, it says Bob Ojeda. Have you ever called him Bob?
No, I have not. No,
I don't think anybody's ever called him Bob.
I mean, the most formal is Bobby O.
Bobby O, that's right. Spaniard.
I just wanted to make sure we were all on the same page here. Here's Jason Wirth leading off the second against Mike Comfrey. Wirth 4-for-7 in this series, hitting just 234 for the year with 146 strikeouts. The Nats have struck out the second most times of any team in the league, and by contrast, their pitchers have struck out the second fewest. That's not a good ratio. However, with the staff that the Nats are building, I think the second part of that's going to change in the next few years.
Well, the best way to go is how Philadelphia's going this year, Gary. It looks like they're going to strike out the most and walk the least, and that's money.
Well, the Phillies today got a shutout performance from Roy Halladay, a complete game six hitter for his 18th win to clinch a postseason berth. Wirth hits it out to right field, and Duda over toward the corner and runs it down for the out. Caught it in fair territory. Wirth retired, one away. The Phillies got their 95th win today. They still have 18 games to go. Let me amend that. They have 16 games to go.
Will they get the magic 108?
They have 13-3, buddy.
13-3? See how tough it is?
Not going to happen.
They'll find out.
We're like proud papas.
That's okay. You're like, you're very protective of your marks. However, you know, the Mariners did win 116.
That's right.
Danny Espinosa takes ball one, but they didn't make it to the World Series that year. So which would you rather have?
I think Dave should look up all the top winners throughout the history of the game. Obviously, Seattle's 116 on top.
Indians.
Well, the and
Indians
how many the teams 108 have done, won 108
well,
or
know,
more,
the,
Dave?
The Indians won 111 in 1954 in 1954 and 154 game schedule,
right,
which is incredible.
Yes.
But they got swept in the World Series by the Giants.
The pickoff play in the first game at second base with Bob Feller on the hill. He was picked off the runner at second. Umpire called him safe. He was out. The next guy got a base hit. Feller lost 1-0.
Wow. Throw in the Willie Mays catch.
And Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes with his 250-foot home runs. I would have loved to have seen a baseball game at the Polo Grounds just because of the oddity of the configuration there. I mean, 257 down the lines, 500 feet to center field.
I would have loved to have seen all the old parks, Forbes Field, Connie Mack,
Crosley Field.
I'd love to see them all.
I'm always intrigued when Polo Grounds, especially when the game's over, you all have to file out through center field together. I thought that's the strangest thing.
Well, Candlestick, we had to go out to the right field bullpen.
But that was only the visiting team. The home team had a tunnel.
Oh, that's right.
The Polo Grounds, both teams had to walk side by side. 2-2 to Espinosa, pulled foul. And, of course, the story is about 51 when the Giants beat the Dodgers in the shot heard round the world game. And the Dodgers, who blew a huge lead, are devastated. And their clubhouse is right next to the Giants clubhouse. And they can hear them celebrating next door. Just crazy. Swing and a miss, and Espinosa down on strike, so Comfrey has his second strikeout.
Well, Pelf hasn't tried anything too much different here in the first couple of innings. Mostly hard stuff, mostly up in the strike zone.
Yep. Well, they got two unusual left-hand hitters. Oh, I shouldn't say unusual. Classic left-hand hitters. Espinosa and Ankiel both love the low ball and are blind upstairs.
Here's Chris Marrero with two out and nobody on. Marrero 2-for-8 in the series. Takes a low strike.
And Marrero, I noticed now, very first night, he just stands so far away from the plate. He is way off that dish.
Lines went into center, and he's got a base hit.
It goes right to your point, Keith. If you stand way off the dish and you try to come inside to that hitter, that's the middle of the plate for Marrero. That ball had the inside corner, but it's middle of the plate.
You're right, Ron. Good call.
Barrera's now hit in six straight games. Second hit off Pelfrey, and here's Jesus Flores, the former Met farmhand who has never let the Mets forget. He's hitting 345 lifetime against the Mets. Between him and the other catcher, Ramos, and you can throw Pudge into that mix too. Mets have not been able to get any of these Nationals catchers out. Flores, of course, missed 2+ years with all sorts of shoulder problems and has only just recently returned to the Nats. He's making his 18th start tonight. There's Pudge, 40 years old, not starting at all these days after coming back from an injury that sidelined him for a month and a half.
One wonders if he'll take it to the house, but he's, 160 hits or so away from 3,000?
It's going to be hard at this point.
Yeah,
he would have to be a number one catcher somewhere or stay around as a backup for 4 or 5 more years, and it's hard to envision him doing that, but you never know.
Doesn't matter. They got a seat for him at the Hall.
Out to center field, and Angel Pagan drifting back. Puts it away to retire Flores. Side retired. A hit and one left to the bottom of the second. David Wright to lead off. No score. Ball on SNY is brought to you by Rums of Puerto Rico. Just think Puerto Rican rum aged by law for true excellence. To learn why Puerto Rico does it better, visit rumcapital.com. By the way, that's beautiful bar fruit. The lemons, the limes, looking very well cut and very healthy. Brad Peacock set the Mets down 1-2-3 in the first inning. David Wright will lead off the second. While we were talking about teams that have won 108 or more, there have been 11 of them.
So the prior to, what was it, 62 when they expanded, when it became a 162-game schedule.
Yeah, 61, right.
So how many teams they were there? I can't read your writing. Jeez.
Well, there was the 06 Cubs won 116. That's the record that the Mariners tied. The 27 Yankees won 110. The 09 Pirates won 110. And the 54 Indians won 111.
So only four teams in the 154-game schedule, 11 total, won 108 or more.
I mean, 108 in 154 games is extraordinary.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, it's pretty extraordinary with 162. I mean, 108 out of 154 is over 700 winning percent.
Wow. It's take 148 and 46. That's what it is.
2-1 to David Wright. David 1-for-7 in this series, just 5 for his last 34. He's seen his average drop to 266. It'll be Wright, Pagan, and Bay for the Mets here in the home second.
David's been pulling that ball foul quite a bit on the ground. Way foul like that.
They've been running that sinker just like that, and it's getting under his bat, and he's been just pulling it. Way foul. And that's because it's kind of getting. Oh, there's the curveball from Peacock.
It's that knuckle curve cool. That he throws.
Good one.
You'll have to educate us, Ronnie, on what differentiates a knuckle curve from a regular curveball.
Okay.
Perhaps we'll get a look at his grip. 3-2 on the way to right, fouled away. He's throwing hard.
Yes, he is.
Kind of just rear back to the throw.
So they throw it with your fingernails, Ronnie?
What they do a lot of times, Keith, now I don't know his grip specifically, but they really will knuckle just with one knuckle. The pointing finger will knuckle, the other finger, middle finger will be straight.
Fly ball out to left, and Morris is right there. So what impact does that have, Ronnie? Does it change the rotation of the ball?
I think for some pitchers it's just comfortability. You know, a lot of pitchers will throw with just their middle finger and have one finger off the ball when they kind of try to get the spin on it. The knuckle curve, what they can do is if they have a good feel for it, they push off with that pointing finger and it gets a little more spin on the ball. But very few people can do it effectively. I mean, think of all the guys we've heard that have done it great. Mussina is the last one I heard that that really was effective with it.
Jason Isringhouse started with that pitch.
And the guy that introduced the pitch was Bert Hooten, right out of the University of Texas, the All-American.
Here's Angel Pagan bluffing a bunt, taking a strike.
And I've faced Bert a lot with the Dodgers and the Cubs. Bert was in his prime, too. The problem with Bert was he just had a straight fastball over the top and didn't throw quite hard enough. But that knuckle curve of his, Ron, had such spin. But it wasn't an off-the-table curve. It just broke a lot.
Just kept breaking right when it started.
Yep.
Well, Bert had that strange motion. He would lean back and almost at a 45-degree angle.
Hooked out to right field by Pagan, and Worth is there. So Peacock showing a lot of weapons. He's got that 95-mile-an-hour fastball, that knuckle curve, and now a couple of changeups to Pagan against the fly ball.
Well, Keith was talking about that ball that David pulled foul. That was a changeup to the right-hander from Peacock. So, like you said, Gary, he pretty well refined.
Here's Jason Bay with two out and nobody on. Bay had his 10-game hitting streak snapped on Monday, sat out last night. Remember Sunday he dove for a ball and bumped his shoulder, which is not the first time he's done that this year. Here's the curveball for a strike. And I wonder with a guy like Peacock, he's had an extraordinary year in the minor leagues this year. He's making his first big league start tonight. Now, normally, you know, you have a young pitcher who has had that kind of year. There's a tremendous amount of hype around that guy. But if you're Greg Peacock and Steven Strasburg is here, Can you kind of fly under the radar and maybe have a little less pressure on him?
It's the best thing that could ever happen to him, and I'm speaking from experience. You know, he can come and just do his job. He's a guy that has all the tools to be a definite 2, 3, 4 kind of starter in your rotation. And also, they love his makeup. Former infielder, shortstop almost all of his career until he picked up pitching late.
And Zimmerman can't make the catch.
My goodness.
So Zimmerman and Flores both staring at it, and Zimmerman lunging at the last moment and unable to secure it. And that keeps Bays turning it back going.
We're going to charge an error on that.
Do you remember when Flores caught his? It's almost like he lost it in the lights. Caught it like with the basket catch. Well, here it looks like Zimmerman gets there in plenty of time and just loses track of the ball.
They say no play, so no error on Zimmerman.
Did you see Flores threw his mask right at the feet of Zimmerman?
I wonder whether that had any impact.
No.
It's embarrassing for an infielder or an outfielder when you drop a pop-up or a fly.
What a stop by Flores. Wow.
Well, with Strasburg and Jordan Zimmerman and this kid and Tom Malone, who we saw in Washington, who will pitch against the Mets tomorrow. Nats have an extraordinarily talented group of young starters who are either in the major leagues or just about major league ready.
They are going in the right direction.
Yep.
You know, they're a couple of years ahead of where the Mets are with that group of young starters. They're the Nats' first round draft picks. Over the last few years, they've been drafting high in the draft. Of course, they had two, you know, once in a generation type guys back to back in Strasburg and Bryce Harper.
And I was saying, we haven't even talked about Harper.
I tell you, their percentage is pretty good. If Bryce Harper pans out to what's expected, and that's some pretty good drafting right there.
Well, they're all here except Harper and Rendon.
We'll see about Marrero. Detweiler has been, you know, up and down. Here's the 1-2, and Bay takes it just off the plate.
Gives that change up away just ever so slightly.
Yep. Now, how quickly can hitters pick up on that? If you guys can see it from here,
they picked it up probably two pitches before.
You pick it up, Gary. There's any alteration in delivery, with arm speed.
What he does is he doesn't slow down his arm. What he does, he has a little tilt where he tilts back to front. He does a little more tilt to kind of almost tell the hitter, I'm going to really come with a fastball, and here's a changeup. Hitters pick that up immediately.
You know, they don't throw the palm ball anymore. John Denny threw a palm ball, and he had a great changeup. But I don't know if I can get a word in real quick here.
Go ahead, word.
Well, John Denny would put the ball in his palm, and he would throw it over the top, and I could see his four fingers above the ball, like Statue of Liberty crown. It's a dead giveaway.
Six in a row retired by Peacock. No score after two. Third inning, Brad Peacock, his first big league at bat, takes a strike. We'll see if this one goes as well as Tom Malone's first big league at bat went against the Mets in D.C. With that first pitch, three-run homer. Of course, Malone came with a reputation as a hitter. Peacock, 1-for-21 this year in the minors, 1-for-25 in his career. Peacock from Palm Beach, Florida, 41st round draft pick, and he wears that number proudly. Of course, anybody wearing 41 and pitching in, you know, this part of the world.
I was saying, lucky he wasn't drafted by the Mets, he'd be in trouble.
Wouldn't get that number. It's up on the wall. I think 41 wears his number when he's stomping grapes. Swing and a miss, and Pelfrey has his third strikeout. I mean, nobody else is allowed to wear it.
I don't have a visual on that.
I think he's a more of a Justin Roper's guy when he's out there with the dogs and the vines.
What does that mean?
Country and Western kind of boot that you use to work.
ride your horses, hang with the dogs, that kind of stuff.
Something out of an L.L. Bean catalog. Yeah. Here's Ian Desmond, had a base in his first time up. David Wright makes another error. Boy, he is in a real fielding slump. Didn't make an error last night, but that's now seven in the last nine games.
Wow. He gets in front and uses two hands and just doesn't come up. Wow. Everything done properly, just didn't make the catch.
You know, there was a time, and not all that long ago, when, you know, David had trouble with throws, and a lot of throwing errors inflated his total. But of late, that hasn't been the issue. He dropped a throw from Reyes in the opening game of this series, and that just a routine grounder.
Probably asking the wrong person, Keith. But
I'm sure you're asking the wrong person.
I know I'm asking the wrong person. Okay, let's wait for this pitch here because this.
A ball called on Pelfrey.
Oh my, that's been a long time. Now Mike's hot.
Well, wait a second. The home plate umpire Dan Iasonia is saying perhaps that he gave time, and they're negating the ball.
Time or was he? No, he was not stepped on the rubber.
Davey Johnson's going to want an explanation.
Watch, he stepped back. Okay, see how he's behind the rubber? He's not on the rubber. He's behind the rubber. Now he gets in, and he stepped back. It looked ugly, and I can see why you would call a balk, but he did step back.
Mike immediately said, "That's not a balk." He read his lips.
And interesting, the home plate umpire had the worst angle of all the umps, and he's the one that overruled it.
Right, because the first and second base umpires, Scott and Beals, both called it a balk. 0-1 to Ankiel. And it's popped up. David Wright rushing in to call off Pelfrey. And that's the second half.
Well, Zim's first at bat, just one first pitch sinker right down the middle. And he topped it. Beautiful setup double play right there.
Can you think of this year without thinking about Pelfrey on the mound and Wright coming up to catch a pop-up?
Yeah, well, of course, that was in Denver. Pelfrey on the mound when Wright and Davis collided. It looked like an innocuous turned ankle at the time that turned into the end of Ike Davis's season. Pitch out, but Desmond not going anywhere.
See, now, the way that execution happened for Pelf, he quick pitched to home. That immediately tells the runner not to run. And then he kind of slowed his motion down to throw the ball into home. You have to take your time, be deliberate, not slow, induce the runner to go. That's how you do execute the pitch out.
1-1 to Zim.
Interesting that Pelfrey, that first at bat, just a sinker away, going after Zimmerman so far with two fastballs. We won't count the pitch out. No, Keith, I was going to ask you before, and Zimmerman up, and Moore's coming. Well, you're the wrong person to ask, but you've certainly played with people that have gone through slumps in the field, haven't you?
Yes.
Where someone doesn't want the ball hit to them, or?
A lot of it. Seven out of ten. If a guy goes into a slump, he's just not a great fielder, but I've seen good fielders go through a stretch, but the good fielders, it never bothers them. The things that stick out in my mind are the Steve Sachs not being able to throw, those kind of quirks. They stick out more to me. A lot of times you got to wonder, managers always look for this in front office, and particularly in the minor leagues, kids coming up, and it's all part of the growth. And it doesn't concern David here. David's a veteran. A lot of guys take their slumps out into the field.
You know, I will say, though, I don't care how many years you play and how well you play. And David's, boy, in the middle of a fantastic career. You miss three or four in a row. You have four or five games where the ball's just not going your way, or you're booting them here and there. You have to. It's got to be in your noodle at some point, and you're thinking about it.
3-2 to Zimmerman. Desmond will be on his way. And That's too high, ball four. So the second walk by Pelfrey puts two men on. And Michael Morris will come to the plate. Here's Morris's first at bat against Pelfrey.
Just ended the inning right here. A little sinker away. Strike one. Sinker just misses outside. Another sinker just misses outside. Another fastball outside. Knee high, swing and a miss. Fastball belt high away. So he just pounded him. Five straight fastballs all the way, Ronnie.
I will tell you, if you're Lucas Duda, be ready, because if he goes first pitch, second pitch out there, Morris is going to try to go the other way.
Well, you talked about it earlier with Marrero. I mean, these guys are so far from the plate, you have no choice but to pitch them away, right?
Or you could start the ball in, Gary, and run it in. Because the one thing about players that are off the plate, it's hard for them to know where that ball is on the inside corner. You can start it there and run it in into that batter's box. That's where you can break some bats.
Two out and two on. And Moore shoots one into right center for a base hit. Desmond around third. He'll come in to score. Pagan's throw is cut off. It's an RBI single for Michael Morris, and the Nats break in front 1-0. So Wright's error leads to a run, and Morris does take it the other way.
Well, it becomes a little bit too predictable. You're going to pick. Look how, look at his stride right here. Keep that frozen, guys. He's striding so far in. Look how close to the plate he is. So he was looking out there. He got five straight pitches away. You know, you might got to change it up.
And that's why Morris is having a great year. He's making the adjustments.
His 86th run batted in. So 1-0 Washington. And here's Jason Wirth with first and third and two out. Wirth flied out to right field his first time.
But Wirth's a big dipper. See when he swings, and maybe we can see that swing again. This is what I see. It's a flaw in his swing that he dips. It's called dipping. Watch his legs and watch his head's right here. Now watch where it winds up. Let it go. And he just comes down. And it's, to me, you're lowering your head in the middle of your swing. And I think that's a flaw in his swing.
And that's one of the reasons he has such a high strikeout total.
It's a lot of fly balls, too.
The 0-2 up the middle, a base hit for Wirth. That'll bring home Zimmerman, and it's 2-0 Washington. Fat pitch on 0-2, and Wirth drives in his 56th run of the year.
You know, I've seen this a lot, and the Mets have done it, and they like to go 0-2 with a sinker ball pitcher and throw the ball up in the strike zone.
No, this is supposed to be out of the strike zone, upstairs, and it's right down the middle, belt high. And see how he dips late there, but that he's. He stayed nice and level on that belt high pitch.
Guys, if you're a sinker ball pitcher and your ball tends to sink, when you're called for a pitch up in the strike zone, your mindset, eye set does not go above the letters. It's just hard for you to throw that ball neck high. And Pelfrey struggled with that one.
Here's Espinosa taking inside. But at this point, is Mike Pelfrey a sinker ball pitcher?
Well, you know, his natural tendency is to sink the ball. He doesn't strike out people. So going up in the strike zone is only for see, only for look. He shouldn't even consider it being a strikeout pitch. Throw it about head high, then go back down. That ball he wants. We see where it's totally sitting. This doesn't make it any easier. He's sitting right like a tee right there. If he hits his glove, which he did, lenient.
You see a lot of catchers in that situation basically stand up.
Mickey Owen it, right?
So the Nats able to take advantage. RBI hits by Morris and Wirth. Both runs will be unearned, and any subsequent runs as well. But Pelfrey still has some work to do here against Espinosa, who struck out his first time up. Wasn't that interesting? I mean, Polino and Pelfrey worked together so well through the middle of the season. It seemed to really put Pelfrey on the right path when he had Polino catching him regularly. But now, over these last, what, three, four starts, Terry Collins has made it a point to have Tolley with Pelfrey, almost as though he's trying to make this combination work. The Mets have decisions to make on both these players, and these will be some of the things that they'll be looking at when the year is over. In the air to right center field, and Pagan makes the call and the catch to end the inning. Two unearned runs for the Nationals after the right error. 2-0 Washington in the third.
The Mets, and we are joined right now by a couple of the award winners that were announced earlier today. The Sterling Awards for the players in the organization who were named Players of the Year for the different level. Josh Satin coming to the plate right now was named Organizational Player of the Year. Organizational Pitcher of the Year is left-hander Darren Gorski, and this year 11-3 down in St. Lucie with a 2.03 ERA. Darren, this is your third year. What clicked for you this year?
Just basically consistency. Staying consistent with my mechanics. And that helped me put a decent outing out when I went out there, give a team a chance to win, and translate into a little bit of success this year.
For the Met fans who are unfamiliar, most of them right now, what do you feature when things are going right for you? What's going right?
Getting strike one. That's the biggest thing. I mean, when you can work ahead and mixing a speed pitcher that throw a slider and changeup, and when you can mix those in a little bit and work ahead in the count, it makes it a lot easier to get guys out.
We're also joined by Cam Marin, guys. He is from Hicksville. He was the Kingsport Player of the Year. This has got to be special for you, being from Hicksville right nearby and growing up as a Met fan.
Yeah, I mean, it was a dream come true when the draft came around and my name was called. And, growing up liking guys like Reyes and Wright and being at Pelfrey's first career start, it's just all a dream come true for me.
Satin down on strikes. As far as you're a catcher, now where have you developed the most? Where do you need the most work right now?
My game calling and how I can handle a snap has definitely improved a lot since high school. Definitely need to work on my throwing a little bit. Strong blocking, that's always been my strong point. Keeping the ball in front, calling the game, things like that.
Matt Harvey's going to join us in a little bit, guys. Last year's number one pick. We'll visit with him in just a little while.
All right, thanks, Chris. One out and nobody on in the home third. Mets down 2-0. Josh Tolley the batter, and he takes it high, ball one. Tolley 1-for-4 in the series, hitting a 261. Brad Peacock in his first big league start has retired the first seven. 2-0 to Tolley. You know, with the Sterling Awards being handed out before the game, honoring all the top minor league players in the Mets system. You want to feel every day as though you've learned a little something. I know I do. And with the best players in the organization here today, I've been curious for months about the young pitcher who pitched in single A and double A for the Mets this year, Familia. As Tolley strokes one out to left, and out comes Morris to grab it, two out. We couldn't figure out for the life of us how you pronounce Familia's first name, because it's J-E-U-R-Y-S. And I've heard seven different pronunciations. So I finally got to ask him today how he pronounces his first name. Jayuris.
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 Okay.
Jayuris.
So it's like there's no accent anywhere on any syllable.
But I was surprised because usually J and, you know, in Spanish is an H sound, but he goes with the J sound. Jayuris. So it's Jayuris Familia, and I told him it's a good thing to know because we'll probably be
calling
his name the next 15 years.
That's right. Yes, why not?
Well, he's one of the bright lights along with Harvey and Zach Wheeler. And Darren Gorski, organization pitcher of the year. He had a great year in St. Lucie this year. Ball and a strike to Pelfrey, who has been swinging the bat much better lately. Five hits on the season, but even his outs have been hard lately. Reyes on deck, 0 for 1 on the night. Average at 3.32, still 3 points up on Ryan Braun, whose game has not yet begun tonight. Brewers playing Colorado again this evening. Kevin Millwood will be the pitcher. Braun last night went only 1 for 5, but it was a pretty good one.
Yeah, it's pretty important, right?
Walk-off home run at the bottom of the 11th.
Two-run bomb, right?
Now the 1-2, and Pelfrey takes it low and away, 2-2.
Did you see where he hit that line drive? It was halfway up that wall in left center. He's got some real, you know, guys. Some guys just have pop, some don't.
And he knew it the moment he hit it. Yeah. He was celebrating on the crack of the bat. 3-2 now to Pelfrey. And it, yeah, I think you're right. I mean, it was one of those balls that just keeps going.
Yeah.
Far beyond what you expect when it leaves the bat.
Keith calls it the two iron shot. It's true.
Yes. 3-2 from Peacock. And Pelfrey gets jammed.
I like this young kid's motion. It's very compact. It's very simple. It's got some velocity to his motion, so he kind of builds up the energy. And I think that's where, even though he's smallish for a major league pitcher, generates a lot of energy.
And now the Mets have their first base runner of the game as Pelfrey draws a two-out walk. Peacock walked only 47 in 147 innings in the minor leagues this year. Route to his 15-3 season. So here's Reyes, who fouled out to the catcher his first time up. It was fascinating both last night and today to hear from Jose and hear from Terry Collins about this strange middle ground that the Mets have to walk right now with Jose, where his hamstring is not well enough for him to do all the things that he would like to, and yet well enough for him to play.
Well, what's been strange for me, and Keith, you addressed it in the open, not strange, how kind of easy it's been for Jose to, you know, not push it to third base the other night when he had a possible triple. Really has stayed stationary as a base runner when he gets to first.
I mean, last night he was on first leading off the seventh inning with the Mets down a run, never moved. In the ninth, got a base hit with two out, tying run, never moved. And, you know, clearly does not feel comfortable stealing bases right now. And, you know, Reyes has had a wonderful year, and he's got so many skills that he brings to the table. As he grounds this one to second, but if he's not running, it certainly takes away a big chunk of his game at his value. After three at Citi Field, 2-0 Washington.
complete game breakdown with exclusive on-field interviews and Rex Ryan's post-game comments. Jets post-game live presented by Toyota Sunday immediately after the Jets-Jaguars game, only on SNY. Chris Marrero leads off in the fourth inning for Washington. Nats leading 2-0 after two unearned runs in the third off Mike Pelfrey, who starts him off with a breaking ball for a strike.
Keith, the guy swings, he's a young hitter now. If he swings at a first pitch, it's a slider in the dirt. Did that tell you he was swinging no matter what the pitch was?
You just don't know his mindset, how he feels at the plate. I know that he's hitting 310 since he's been called up. He's got a long swing. He's one of those guys I think's got to start early.
Okay.
You see a lot of guys guessing today, young hitters guessing a lot. And whatever, you go.
Now Pelfrey ahead 1-2. And Marrero hits one up the middle. So he's 2-for-2, both times taking it to center field. And the Nationals have their fifth hit off Pelfrey.
Difference, this one was away, not inside.
Yeah, I believe you got to pitch this guy. Well, that's right. The first one was in very good, Ron. This is a slider that just kind of stays on the same plane.
So the Nationals have the leadoff man on. Now the number 8 hitter, Jesus Flores, who fly to center his first time up. He talked about young hitters guessing. You know, we addressed it last night, the issue of all the 3-1 fastballs we've seen taken for strikes this year in RBI situations. Happened with Nick Evans last night, but it's been, you know, it's been rampant, not just with the Mets, but throughout baseball over the last few years. As Flores fouls off the breaking ball. And, you know, I asked Terry Collins today, I said, do you think that the emphasis on on-base percentage and drawing walks has made hitters more passive? And he said, no. He said, what I think is the guys guess in those situations. And I'm at a loss. Why would you be guessing anything but fastball on 3-1 if that's the case?
Well, it just seems to me that if you're going to guess, say, breaking ball, if you're 3-1, it's become more experienced in knowledge of the strike zone. You should be able to advance mentally with your at bat. Your approach is that I'm getting hit my pitch to hit. I'm looking for a fastball, and that pitcher thinks he's going to throw a little get me over curveball, you know, this little spinner. I'm going to be covering that too, and then learn to take, okay, if he throws you a backdoor nasty one or down and in, take it because it's your pitch to hit. But you certainly don't want to let a fastball pass. Every hitter that comes up loves a fastball. Now, I have played with guys, and not everybody can hit a curveball without looking for it. There's a lot of hitters that just can't adjust, so those hitters do have to guess. But I think the great majority of guys, if you don't, you know, I just find it hard to believe that they've come this far and they all need to guess because, you know, they look on the charts and this pitcher throws 65% breaking ball. My thought, and I said it before, Garrett, I know I'm repeating myself, is I was taught from my father and all the way up, but to be in anticipation of the breaking ball, looking fastball, therefore you're not set on one pitch and then you can't catch up to a fastball.
Little bloop, long way to go for Tejada, and he makes the sliding grab. Now looking for the double play, and he's got it. An outstanding play by Ruben Tejada.
Well, it's the heads up here too, not taking for granted. He has no idea where that runner is. His focus is on the ball, his back's to first base, and he has the sense to get up and just didn't take anything for granted.
You know, I think one of the things that people never talk about is Marrero gets cut off, Keith. Never talk about, they always talk about the range of an infielder on ground balls. They never talk about the range on those little pops, and Tejada is outstanding at that. And if dude is going to play right field, that's a very important play.
That's some bad base running right there by that young man, and he knows it.
So it's a 4-3 double play. Second double play turned by the Mets tonight. Now Peacock, the pitcher, swings through it, and it's 0-2.
you see so many base runners, Gary. We've seen a lot over the years. Getting caught on that kind of pop up, going back and forth in the baseline, which is just indecision.
Pelfrey has his fourth strikeout as Peacock is down looking. To the bottom of the fourth we go. Ruben Tejada showing off his glove. Nobody else was in the neighborhood. And Tejada pops right up and doubles off Marrero.
High-speed pitch. Brad Peacock is topped out at 95, and Mike Pelfrey somewhere around 95.
Nice.
Peacock is not allowed to hit over his first three innings. His second big league appearance, his first start. Ruben Tejada leads off for New York after that fine defensive play in the top of the inning. Tejada flied to center his first time up. It'll be Tejada, Duda, and Wright for the Mets as they look to get something started here in the bottom of the fourth. Mets scored just two runs in each of the first two games of this series against Washington. Tejada hits one toward the middle, and the Mets have their first hit. That's what Ruben Tejada needs to be doing. Take him off the middle, and the Mets have the leadoff man onto the fourth. Now Lucas Duda will stride to the plate. Duda flying to left his first trip.
Well, we were talking to Terry Collins before the game today. He said sometimes you get faced pitchers that throw a lot of first pitch strikes. Peacock's been 9 of 11. So you have to make the adjustment, start maybe hunting for fastballs on first pitch or early in the count.
Well, it has certainly been an organizational mantra this year for the Mets to be more patient, draw more walks, and it's been successful. The Mets lead the league in walks. They're second in the league in on-base percentage. But they've also left the most runners on base, which I guess is a byproduct of, you know, having a lot of people on base. But he talks about what we were talking about before. That ball gets through Flores and Tejada will go to second.
Should be a pass ball.
Should
there.
Be.
fastball to his right. I will tell though, it's a tough play for a catcher. You're sitting up there in the outside corner. You figure a pitcher with a fastball can throw it to you, and he pulls it across the plate.
And they're going to score it a wild pitch.
Okay.
They're going to score to the fastball.
Now Peacock behind for a rare time tonight. 2-0 to Duda with right on deck. He throws the 2-0 off speed pitch, and it's 2-1. That's interesting.
I just don't like that at all. You got a kid with a good arm like this, and you see a lot of it's called pitching. What's it called?
Defensively.
You know.
It's a fastball for a strike. I think it certainly bespeaks a certain amount of confidence in his secondary stuff that he'll throw a 2-0 changeup, though.
Yeah, but he didn't throw it for a strike.
Right.
And it's the first time that they've seen him. So you would, I don't know, if you were pitching, you would think that 94 down has got to be the equal of Duda, even at 2-0, when he threw the changeup.
Oh, boy, nice changeup there.
You know, it's called, I don't know what it's called pitching backwards, Ronnie.
Right, there's
a term in our time. Pitchers that would throw ahead in the count, they would be aggressive inside with the fastball and then behind the count breaking ball. If you can do it and you got good secondary stuff and good command, you're going to win.
Which means he's susceptible to a fastball in right now if the change up away.
And a lot has to do with they know that dude is a good fastball hitter.
Peacock's 3-2, and Duda fouls off the fastball.
No, it's interesting. When he goes in his stretch, he brings the glove to his waist, and that's when he gets the grip.
You see that? Notice that.
He doesn't get it till the end.
He really wiggled that glove, and just wondering if it's a pattern on a pitch. But you're right. I noticed that, Ronnie, and a big wiggle of that glove, too.
Now, the key is if you wiggle all the time, you're good to go.
He didn't. Fastball.
Hello.
Rusty stop. Is Rusty in the building?
I don't think we're supposed to tell secrets like that up here.
So many different ways of tipping your pitches.
So.
We'll take another look.
Curveball, did he go? He held the swing in time, Stevie Buckner says, and so Duda's on with a walk. Second walk given up by Peacock. With David Wright's first at bat.
Good at bat by Lucas there. Fastball down for a strike. Here's the fastball in. It was not called. Comes back with a little fastball down again, and then 2-1 changeup that he pulled foul. So we see already from Peacock that he likes to throw that changeup when he's behind in the count. And still hard stuff with David, and David just missed that pitch. Fastball up.
David got a couple calls there in that at bat. Pitches that could have gone the other way.
So the Mets have their first real scoring threat. First and second and nobody out. David flying to left. Tejada with a hit. Duda with a walk. And now right against Peacock. Trying to shoot one the other way, and he fouls it off.
Been pretty consistent, hasn't it, guys, for the last 2 or 3 weeks, in my mind anyways, from sitting up here, Gary. Almost at least one of the first two pitches is a fastball into David. Every at bat, it doesn't matter what pitcher, they are making sure that he's aware of the fastball inside.
And really, hasn't that been going on for two years now?
Yeah.
Ever since he got hit?
They're popping him inside every chance they get.
Now, I will say this. When David first came back from the disabled list this year after 2 months off, he got on top of the plate and he was handling that inside pitch better than he had since Matt Cain hit him.
Well, he had his focus on shortening his swing up, and not shortening up, but being more level. He's pulling everything foul. Staying level and on top
of the fastball. You know, and old habits are hard to break. And David got into that as a changeup again.
So you think the difference is that his swing just gets long when he struggles?
Yes, yeah. And I think he's the bad habits he got into with the uppercut a little bit and start going for the home runs. You know, that he it's hard to maintain that focus over months. This is a game of months. And you will go back and revert back to your old habits. There's a dig in right there. Fastball. So this kid has got a nice potential to be a pretty good pitcher, I think, Ron.
Fairly balanced. More to the full side, of course, but not overwhelmingly so.
David has always used the other field. The opposite field.
Again, the 0-2 and the curveball away. Well, it was certainly the case for a long time in David's career that he would hit a lot of home runs the other way. That's pretty much negated by this ballpark. Or unless you hit it right down the line to right field, you're just not going to hit opposite field home runs. And two curveballs in a row from Peacock. 2-2 to right. Tejada at second, Duda at first, and nobody out. 2-0 Washington in the fourth.
He's got a decent read on that knuckle curve. Two of them in the dirt to right he took, but 3-2 in the dirt to Duda, taken for a ball.
Well, you know, you've noted a couple of ways in which he has maybe given away some of his pitches, both on the changeup and on the grip. To right center field. Ankiel back in the gap along with Worth, and Worth makes the catch. Tejada tags and goes to third. So right driving one the other way for the first down.
See, that's not good.
Why?
It's too much of a bend. I know he's a little more crouched.
You know, Keith, if you watch this, watch his feet. You know, you want to have a foundation, a really strong foundation. Watch what his feet do, both of them now. Not one, watch both. Back one's gone.
You want that backside, I think, to be a little firmer, you know, to deliver. It wasn't as bad as I originally thought. It's not, I mean, he's just not squaring up right now. He's a little tardy. And then that was a change up of the out over the plate, and it got towards the label on him. He's just not squaring it up in today's terminology. His bat is just lagging that little fraction behind, and that's all it takes.
I'm glad you finally come around to today's technology.
Pagan flied out to right his first time up. Tejada at third, Duda at first with one out. Pagan's been outstanding all year, getting a runner in from third with less than two out, but here will have to work from behind. Tom Borzolani on call in the bullpen. Don't know what pitch count Peacock might be on tonight in his first big league start. Here's the 0-2, and Pagan fouls it off. Needless to say, with Peacock having thrown 147 innings in the minor leagues this year and being as hot a property as he is, they're probably not going to go too far with him tonight.
Man, he threw a lot of pitches, I'm sure. 177 strikeouts is tremendous. And that amount of innings pitched.
Again, the 0-2 to Pagan, and it's in there for a call, strike three. Out of looking at the fastball, And Peacock has his second strikeout and gets one in a big spot.
See, I think that Peacock should, well, we'll do this first. Bates, if I bat, curveball inside corner, strike one. Fastball up and in, fouled off. Fastball upstairs, fouled off. Curveball in the dirt, misses badly, one and two. High fastball upstairs, fouled back, one and two. Another fastball, there might have been a change. There's the change. Another fastball in. So he just pounded him in, Ronnie, and up.
I will say, though, Jason had some of the better swings anyone's had off of Peacock first time through that lineup.
This kid likes to pitch inside.
Well, the Mets had first and second and nobody out. First and third, one out. And now in danger of being turned away empty-handed. Two and zero now to Bay with Josh Satin waiting on deck. Tejada and Duda on the corners with two down. Too high. Now it's 3-0. 23-year-old Brad Peacock. His first big league start. Awfully impressive.
Could give Bay the hit sign here.
We see him throw a 3-1 changeup. Would he throw a 3-0 curveball or changeup?
You'd have to take it, wouldn't you?
That's a strike with a fastball.
Let's see if it's a 3-1 fastball. Let's see if it's put into play.
The way they've been pitching him in, and they're going to throw the changeup. How about that?
And it's ball four.
That was fairly predictable. And I just think, you know, sometimes that's going to be it.
No, that's McCaddy coming out. So they'll leave him in.
Oh, that's right. I thought it was Davey. My fault. I just agree with that pitch selection right there, Ronnie. Just air it out. Take a chance.
I think you've said it many times. The worst pitch to throw is that get me over changeup or breaking ball when you're behind in the count. It just spins in there. He's lucky that wasn't a strike.
It's the pitch you want to throw first pitch, right?
Yeah. I mean, you're going to make less mistakes with your fastball, especially when your strength is your fastball.
Where's Lonnie to get himself ready? As Peacock is in his first crisis here in the fourth.
Let's put some of the onus on the catcher, though. He has more time, not a lot, but more time than Peacock. And that might even be called from the bench. Let's go after the rookie instead of the veteran Bay.
Now, as a hitter coming up here right now, Gary, you are set. Bases loaded. He's walked two batters in this inning. He's worked hard. You're sitting on a fastball first pitch.
Josh Satin today named the Mets Organization Player of the Year for a big year at Binghamton and Buffalo. 2-for-7 in the big leagues after striking out his first time up. Looking for his first major league RBI. And first pitch curveball for ball one.
Even better. Now you're 1-0. He's trying to get a little curveball over to get ahead. Now he's behind with a curve. You've really got him in a tough spot. Notice that Satin chokes up, and you see the defense right there. They're playing back pretty much straight up, deep on the infield with two outs.
1-0 from Peacock, and it's a strike to Satin.
That could have gone either way. Key for hitters, the key thing here is that base hit, right? You don't need to hit the ball at the ballpark. You'd love to. Boy, you'd love to, but.
There was a beautiful article, I gave it to you yesterday on the Investor's Business Daily, Ron. I have a biography on Harmon Killebrew yesterday. And Killebrew, who hit over 500 home runs, and when he retired, well, he has the most home runs per at bat. The ratio, only Babe Ruth has the better one than him. But Killebrew, you read the article,
yeah,
said, I didn't go up swinging for a home run when a base hit was needed.
Knew the situation.
Yep.
One and two to Satin. Josh fouls back the fastball. Satin is 26. He's been a hitter throughout his minor league career. The problem has been finding a position for him. He was somewhat challenged as a second baseman. They've tried him at third. They're trying him now at first base. It's kind of a, in that respect, kind of a right-handed Daniel Murphy.
There you go. Although Murph's done it here as far as the hitting is concerned.
I'll tell you what, 1-2 right now, three straight fastballs. There's Strasburg. I mean, throw a little yellow hammer right here.
Base is loaded, two out, 1-2 to Satin. And the curveball just missed. 2-2.
That was his best curveball, and good job by Iasonia. That ball was off the corner. Good eye by Josh. Starts on the outside corner. 6 inches outside.
30 pitches already this inning for Brad Peacock. So he might be done, and even if he gets Satin out here. Now on 2-2, Satin lifts one behind third base. And Zimmerman nabs it into their territory to end the inning. Peacock pitches in and out of trouble and holds on to a 2-0 lead.
Award winners, young men throughout the organization who had terrific 2011. First of all, it's Danny Muno, who played in single A Brooklyn, hit 355 this year, a Brooklyn record. First of all, how do you come right out of college ball as an eighth round pick out of Fresno State and have that kind of success that early?
Well, first of all, I got to give a shout out to the scout who drafted me, Doug Thurman, for giving me that opportunity, and for the Mets to give me that opportunity to put me in Brooklyn. It was just an amazing experience just to be able to play in front of those Brooklyn Cyclone fans.
For you, hitting with the wooden bat for the first time, but wasn't the first time. You got a little help in getting ready for it by playing in a Cape Cod League.
Yeah, I struggled a little bit in the Cape Cod League and learned how to deal with adversity, and that kind of helped me figure things out, and took that into Brooklyn.
466 on base. He figured it out all right. And of course, last year's number one pick, Matt Harvey, joins us. He's the St. Lucie Performer of the Year, and you split your year between St. Lucie and Binghamton. First of all, Matt, at the beginning of the year and at the beginning of your time in Binghamton, struggled a little bit, but you settled down in both instances. What was the big difference in just getting comfortable?
Just not putting too much pressure on yourself, and just, you know, pitching's pitching, and you know, I just tried to, at the beginning, go out there and do too much. And, you know, I learned quick that, you know, it's baseball, and pitching is what it is at every level. You just got to make your adjustments, and I was able to do that.
Desmond grounds out to Reyes for the first out here in the fifth. Do you put a timetable on yourself for when you want to be here?
I mean, everyone wants to be here. It's everyone's dream, and, you know, we're all working hard to get here, so. During this offseason, I'm going to do everything I can to get ready, and whenever that happens, it happens.
You know, Matt, when you take a look at your repertoire, what do fans have to look forward to from seeing you pitch, especially when you're on?
You know, I'm going to go out there fighting, and I like to, you know, last as long as I can in the game. And, you know, whether I'm keeping the team and the chance to win, and, you know, it's something I'm going to go out there every time and try and do. So, you know, winning is my goal, and that's what I'm going to try and do.
Couple of young men with a bright future as Ankiel flies out. Gary, back up to you.
All right, thanks, Chris. And certainly we've heard a lot about Matt Harvey. And he, Chris made a great point, because at each level this year, he had his struggles, both in St. Lucie and in Binghamton. But he was able to right the ship, kind of figure out the next level. And he's a guy who asks a lot of very smart questions.
Yes. Well, Harvey's got all the tools to make it to this level. Take some time. And I thought it was interesting that Munoz, the young man who hit 355 in Brooklyn, thanked the scout, because a lot of times it's a scout in your area that finds you at Fresno State and gives you an opportunity or sells you to the organization. Said, this kid can play. You got to draft him.
Telling you, Fresno, that's first round for the Mets. Tejada with another chance near the line and handles it flawlessly to retire Zimmerman. First 1-2-3 inning for Pelfrey, keeps it 2-0. Pack includes four men's tickets, four vouchers for Nathan's hot dogs or Brooklyn burgers, Nathan's french fries, and Pepsi soft drinks. Get to Mets.com for your tickets now. Asia Delta keep climbing. Actually, it's an Acela fifth inning recap. 2-0 Washington. Couple of unearned runs in the third inning off Mike Pelfrey, who just had his first 1-2-3 inning. Brad Peacock in his first major league start. Three outs shy of going the required five to get a win. The Nats will keep the bullpen working as it was working in the fourth inning behind Peacock. Tolley lined out to left his first time up. And Josh swings through the fastball. And it's 1-1. Mike Pelfrey on deck. Then Jose Reyes for the Mets in the fifth. Talking about the Sterling Award winners tonight, top players in the Mets minor league system. The Buffalo recipient of the Sterling Award will pitch for the Mets tomorrow night. That is Chris Schwinden, who will make his second big league start. There was some talk about Schwinden being shut down after that first start he made for the Mets, which was not a very impressive one, but after giving him some extra time, he will go out and pitch tomorrow. And Terry Collins said he'll probably pitch at least another start after that. Mm-hmm. 1-2 to Tolley. Over the mound. Desmond to his left. The quick toss got him.
What is the word on Mr. Santana, Gare?
Well, there was some talk about Johan pitching for Savannah in their championship series in the South Atlantic League, but according to Terry Collins, Santana said that he did not want to put himself in the position of winning or losing a championship for those youngsters down in Savannah, you know, at a time when he's still trying to work his way back on rehab. So they have decided not to do that. And instead, Johan's going to throw a simulated game Sunday down in Port St. Lucie. And then as Pelfrey bloops one into the glove of Marrero for the second out, and then go to the instructional league, do some work until the end of October, and then shut it down.
That is absolutely the right thing to
yes.
do, because Gary, what happens if Johan, who's been very conservative and very he's made great judgments about when to push it, when to pull back. What happens if he loosens up in their championship game and he can't go? You know, it really upends their whole staff. So that was the right decision to make for Johan, Savannah, and the Mets.
And, of course, there had been talk also about Santana eventually pitching an inning or two here before the end of the year. That is now off the table as well. Here's Reyes, who's 0 for 2 tonight. Reyes with his 0 for 2 is at 331. Ryan Braun is 0 for 1 in his game tonight. He's at 329. So Reyes still 2 points to the good. And Peacock keeps getting ahead of the hitters up on Reyes 0-2.
Well, two changeups there in a row to Reyes, one for a strike, one for a swinging strike. The one thing you have to like about Peacock watching him now, 85 pitches, pretty good, great ball to strike ratio. So he can throw three pitches over with a good fastball. That's pretty impressive.
Ball and two strikes to Reyes.
Steve McCaddy, the pitching coach, with the staff that they're starting to assemble here, he's got to be on the top step of the dugout.
And the curveball fouled off. Well, it's a double-edged sword, isn't it? You're a pitching coach for a team that has so much young talent. You're blessed with the talent part, but you have to really keep an eye on the young part.
Yeah, you got
to
mold it. Mm-hmm. Mr. Strasburg.
And the Mets will miss in this series. Of course, he's making all his starts here in September at home. 2-2 to Reyes. They pulled him after three innings in his second start with 57 pitches, which was 13 shy of his pitch limit. Davey said he didn't want to have to pull him in the middle of an inning. And Strasburg was a little hot about that.
He should be hot. He's worked so hard to come back. And, you know, this pitch limit is pretty shallow as it is.
Just missed Reyes, and it's 3-2. Well, he'll have two more starts this year at least. And then coming off Tommy John surgery, should be good to go at the front of the rotation for the Nationals when the year begins in 2012. 3-2 from Peacock, and Reyes pokes one through the hole of base in. Hit number 165 for Jose Reyes.
Well, nice at bat for Jose there. And at this point, with him fighting for the batting crown, with Steve Braun.
Steve Braun
is my teammate in St. Louis. That's why I messed up. Ryan Braun, one a day will keep the doctor away.
Well, that gets him back up to 333 with that base hit. Braun, as we mentioned, 329, 0 for 1 tonight. So they're right where they started the night. Reyes at first with two down, and now Tejada, who singled up the middle to start the fourth inning, 1-for-2. And Rubin takes low and away, 1-0. And how far will they go with Peacock? He's up to 90 pitches now. They want to get him this one out. They've got Gorzolani ready.
And this is last hitter right here. A couple of reasons. One is that he's faced Tejada. You don't want to face him, have him face Duda with a chance to lose the ball game. Lefty, lefty. pitch count.
And that fastball that was 94, 95 is now 91. I'll tell you, he's getting a little weary.
He's on also his first start. He's all bundled up inside. He's going to take a deep breath when he's out of this game.
He's not even paying any mind to Reyes at first, but Reyes just not in running mode right now. And the curveball looped foul. 1-2.
What happens when you have your first start, or, you know, he had that first relief appearance, is that adrenaline that is just beating those first 2-3 innings, that tank is empty by now. And you are weary. Even though you might not be physically your arm weary, you are weary mentally from the stress of the whole day.
One, two. And Tejada flies one out to right. Worth over near the line. Side retired, so Peacock has his five innings in. Shutout ball on his first big league start. 2-0 Nats after five. Michael Morris, first pitch swinging in the sixth inning, lifts one out to Duda in right field. So Pelfrey with one pitch retires the first batter in the sixth. Brad Peacock, five scoreless innings in his first big league start, and gets a nice job from Davey Johnson.
I've gotten a couple of those. That's a good feeling.
Nicely done.
So it'll be up to the Nationals bullpen to get him 12 outs and his first big league win. Jason Worth has one of the two RBIs for the Nationals. They got both their runs in the third, both unearned. Worth has five hits and nine bats in this series as he tries to finish strong in his first of 7 years in Washington. That's one more than a senator. And he gets paid better.
That's right.
Toward the hole, Reyes on the backhand and the running throw on a hop, and Satin scoops it out. Beautifully done by Reyes, and Satin with his second pickup of the night.
Well, nice play by Jose here. We've seen it so many times. Throwing on the run. Nice pick by a young Satin. Nice play by the veteran. I was robbed.
You reminded every once in a while just how tremendous his arm is. I've said it before. I mean, those are plays that no one else. Maybe Tulowitzki with the jump throw that he uses, but there's two guys maybe in all of the major leagues who can make that play.
Now, Danny Espinosa. Well, let me ask you this, because of all this talk since last night about Reyes still feeling the hamstring and not running all out of the bases and not stealing bases right now. What about a play like that? I mean, that takes a lot of strain on your hamstring, I would think, and yet he was able to make that.
That's why I think he's throwing on the run instead of maybe not planting, and we've seen some throws in the dirt.
Drag bunt on a hop, Satin throws it behind Pelfrey, and Espinosa has a bunt hit. Well, once Satin couldn't catch that ball out of the air, Espinosa was golden.
Well, Pelf had a chance too here. It was a perfect parachute right between them, and it wouldn't have mattered. He was going to beat it anyway.
I mean, that's getting rewarded for a bad bunt. That's not a good bunt.
No.
Just got lucky.
That's very lucky. Like a Phil Mickelson, loft of L wedge.
So it's a bunt hit for Espinosa, the sixth hit for the Nationals as Marrero comes up. But getting back to Reyes, you think that planting and throwing would put more.
Well, you said strain. It. I mean, there's stress on the hamstring when you throw, too. And you got to plant deep and make a throw. And I think I've seen Jose, since he's been hurt, throw more balls in the hole where he hasn't. He's thrown the short hop over to first base or a long hop. I haven't seen that before. He's always had the strength of the arm to throw it across the infield. He's got such a great arm, and I think it's his leg. I really do.
Espinosa can steal a base. 14 on the year. Belfry's already given up one steal tonight. Desmond back in the first.
You saw your slide step there by Pelf, trying to keep Espinosa close.
Herrera twice has hit the ball back up the middle for base hits. And he drives this one to center field, chasing Pagan back. Angel slowing and making the grab. Made that one look easy on a ball hit over his head. 2-0 Washington in the sixth. One side, SNY.TV, the ultimate blog network featuring a continuous flow of sports news straight from the best New York sports blogs. SNY.TV, your online home of all things New York sports. The veteran left-hander Tom Gorzolani comes out of the bullpen for Washington.
Well, he's done a pretty good job since he's gone into the bullpen. A guy who, when Strasburg came off,
had to go in that pen. He pitched a lot from the bullpen when he was both in Chicago and Pittsburgh.
Mets have beat him up this year. They've already beaten him twice. He has a 5.57 ERA against New York. And he'll be called upon to protect the first part of Brad Peacock's 2-0 lead. Peacock went 5 innings in his first big league start. No runs, 2 hits, 3 walks, 2 strikeouts, and a wild pitch. 94 pitches for Peacock.
Well, the Nationals tried to do this trick last night, didn't they? 5 innings from their starting pitcher and then 4 innings of shutout ball. They did it last night.
It worked. Bullpen gave up only 2 hits, and they both came with 2 out of the 9th inning. Peacock has a lot to smile about. 23-year-old right-hander from Florida certainly showed off what the Nationals can expect from him. 3-4-5 in the Mets batting order. Duda, Wright, and Pagan up against Gorzolani. And Duda takes ball one. Lucas is flying to left and drawn a walk tonight, 0-1. Roger Bernardina has lots of time on his hands.
And one thing about starting pitchers, there's a day game tomorrow, correct?
Yes.
He's not playing tomorrow.
What are you envisioning for the young man?
Hey. I see great things for him.
In the big city? Espinoza staggers but grabs the pop up one away. Here's David Wright. Let's take it back to his last at bat of the fourth.
Well, first pitch, fastball away, fouled back. Fastball inner half, fouled back. Davis Maddie couldn't square it up. Fastball away, fouled back. Curveball misses outside. Another curveball in the dirt misses. 2-2. Change up. That was a pitch to hit. Had a lot of plate, but it got in on his label a little bit. And, you know, David had a fastball, a pitch in there before. One of the fastballs that he should have ripped. And he's just not, like I said, getting the bat squared up. You can see the frustration on his face after he fouls those pitches off. Those are pitches that he should rip, and he's taking good cuts, but it's just not quite getting it there.
David in a 5-for-36 hole right now. Gorzolani finds the inside corner, 0-2.
I've always thought Gorzolani's better in this role anyway. He's the kind of guy that can throw like 3 or 4 miles an hour more when he comes out of the bullpen, which he needs that extra.
He's been a starter the vast majority of his career. First came up with the Pirates in 05 as David is hit by the pitch. So the Mets have a 1-out base runner. Let's check in with the studio. Kevin Burkhardt standing by with the New York State Smokers quit line game break. It's been funny for Carlos since he went over to San Francisco. He struggled early, then he got hurt, came back, struggled again. But now with the Giants virtually out of it, he is raging hot. A little too late. Angel Pagan is 0-for-2, flied out and took a call third strike. Right at first with one out, and Angel pulling off that fastball, nothing and one. Angel has not hit a right-handed home run this year. All 7 of his home runs have come as a left-hand batter. Jason Bay on deck.
Gotta keep that ball away, huh? I guess. Fooled him twice.
First pitch fastball away. This one a little changeup.
Gorzolani ahead 0-2 on Pagan. And that changeup misses. Ball and 2 strikes. shortstop. Orzolani now 29 years old. In his first year with the Nationals. Pitched for the Cubs the last year and a half after moving over from Pittsburgh where he began his career. Came up about the same time as Paul Mahalan.
Yeah.
And the Pirates thought they were going to have a 1-2 left-handed punch for years to come. And neither one of them has been quite what they had hoped. There goes Wright, and Pagan strikes out. The throw by Flores, safe.
Ooh.
Stolen base number 12 for David Wright. It's Pagan strikes out for the second out.
Very close. Well, Flores doesn't even take a step, throws that flat footed, but right on the bag.
Oh boy, I tell you what, he could have rang him up there, couldn't he?
He just did get in. Good call.
Remember, Flores is a guy who has had nothing but shoulder problems the last 2.5 years. It's a pretty impressive Good. Throw for a guy coming back from shoulder issues. So Wright is in scoring position with two out. Here's Jason Bay, who's popped up and walked 0 for 1. Mets have managed only two hits tonight. A single by Tejada in the fourth, a single by Reyes in the fifth. That's been it. Here's your Coors Light freeze cam.
Very close. What is it, every hour on the hour, top of the hour, there LaGuardia starts to take off? The planes, is always like 8 o'clock. I remember the planes start taking off on LaGuardia, and then 9 o'clock, and then 10 o'clock. It's like, geez. They're all going to Chicago, too. United to Chicago.
I'll have to check the schedule. Google flight search is launched now. I can check on there.
Well, considering they go off every hour, maybe that's why it's a little delayed over there occasionally.
If everybody's leaving at the same time, it's a problem. Mike Pelfrey hoping the Mets can get him some runs. He's pitched pretty well tonight. 2-1 the count to Bay. And it's bounced toward the hole. Desmond with the throw on a hop, not nearly in time, but by keeping the ball in the infield, keeps Wright from scoring. An infield hit for Jason Bay. Not quite Jose Reyes.
No.
And really, he's telling, isn't it? I mean, that's the same play. Maybe a little more speed by Jason Bay, but very similar play.
Well, it's a ball that in retrospect he probably should have eaten, because you throw that ball away and Wright scores.
Or Zimmerman could have tried to get back to third base. He didn't make any effort to get back to third and try to get the lead runner.
So another chance for Josh Sadden to notch his first big league RBI. He popped up with the bases loaded to end the fourth. Now up with first and third and two out. Sadden 0 for 2 on the night. Josh grew up in California.
Well, here's the throw by Reyes, and well, just about the same play, is it not? And much more mustard on a throw.
Just not the same arm.
Yeah. Yep.
And you know, it's not often that you can see that just at the ball coming out of a guy's hand, but you can see so much more velocity on that ball just leaving Reyes's hand as opposed to Desmond.
Arm speed. That's what it's all about. Arm speed. He's got it, and Desmond does not have it as much. Desmond on that throw had more air under it and threw it shorter.
In his defense,
I know.
Few guys do.
We're not picking on you, Ian. It's just that Reyes is special talent.
Was Lonnie hit 0-2 on Satin? And Josh is down swinging to end the inning. So Satin's left 5 runners on in his last 2 at bats. 2 strikeouts for Gorzolani after 6 2-0 Nets. most batting titles in Major League history. Well, I would get a response from my partners, but they stepped out. Jesus Flores leads off. And you know how Kramer was a seat holder at the awards ceremonies on Seinfeld? Well, we have Al, our cameraman, and Dave, our stat guy. They're our seat holders because Heath and Ron just, they stepped out. Right, maybe they were off winning an award. I don't know. You guys want to say hi?
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Mom.
Those are the first intelligible words that Dave has ever said in this booth. Flores is 0 for 2, and he takes it low and away, 2 and 1. So Ronnie has moved into the stat chair, and Keith is on camera, too. Now, Keith, I know you've done this before, so I'm not going to even worry about you handling your position well. There he is. All right, Al has given up. He is not letting Keith touch his camera for more than a couple of seconds. Ronnie just passed me a stat note. Says Al has had 2 Cracker Jacks today. That's the stat of the day. 2-2 to Flores, who's flied out and hit a pop fly that Tejada turned into a double play, and he goes down swinging. It's been a good night for Pelfrey. His 5th strikeout, just 1 shy of his season high.
Good slider right there off the plate.
Oh, you guys are back.
Yes.
Welcome back.
By the way, Al leads the National League in camera twos for Cracker Jack consumption.
Yeah, and who leads Major League color announcers in the same category? Might be a certain number 17. Gorzolani will take the turn bat.
Did Al and Dave get some FaceTime?
They got FaceTime. They also said words.
So Dave is the mystery man who you've been exposed.
Well, as I said,
it's not my fault the FBI shows up out in your door tonight. They know where you're at now.
As I said when Dave said hi, Mom, on the air, I said those are the first intelligible words he's spoken.
I was going to say he's been exposed for a couple of years now.
So, did you guys have a meeting to go to?
I just wanted to see if they had those icicles back there. They don't. They locked up.
Strike 3 called. Gorzolani down looking, and Pelfrey matches the season high with his 6th strikeout. All the way around, it's been a good outing for Pelfrey. He hasn't allowed an earned run tonight. He gave up a couple of 2-out hits to Morrison Worth that plated runs in the 3rd. Has had a couple of really nice plays made behind him by Tejada and Reyes, but all in all, Pelfrey has to feel good about this outing. Here's Desmond, who's 1 for 3, singled back in the 1st. And the curveball in for a strike. Pelfrey's due a turn and bat in the bottom of the inning, so this will be his final go-around. 92 pitches for the night, so that's another plus for Mike. Yeah. He's been able to keep the pitch count down. Past the mound, but Reyes is there behind the bag and guns down Desmond to end the inning. Pelfrey retires 11 of the last 12. He's down 2-0. Hobbs Discount Furniture, proud to be the furniture store of the New York Mets. And by Bigelow Tea, the green tea of choice for New York sports legends Joe Torre, Wayne Gretzky, and Phil Simms. Tom Borzolani, who worked in and out of trouble in the sixth inning, stays on for the seventh. The Nats with a 2-0 lead. Justin Turner will bat for Josh Tolley. And then Ronnie Foligno on deck to bat for Mike Pelfrey as the Mets try and fashion some offense. They've had just three hits tonight. Miguel Batista getting ready in the Mets bullpen. Now with Josh Swindon taking a spot in the rotation. Batista, who's made two starts, gets shuffled to the bullpen. Turner 0 for 3 in this series. Hits one deep toward left center field. Morse won't get this. It's up the gap into the wall. And Turner motors into second with the Mets' first extra base hit of the night. A leadoff double for Justin Turner as a pinch hitter.
Well, makes the skipper look good here. Love this angle. Very nice.
Turner's now 4 for 8 as a pinch hitter this year.
He doesn't let the fastball pass. That's why he's successful.
So now Ronnie Foligno will try and move him along. Mike Pelfrey's only chance to win is for the Mets to get him 3 runs here in the seventh inning. 1-0 to Foligno. Ronnie just 1 for 12 as a pinch hitter this year. Facing his former battery mate Borzolani. They were together in Pittsburgh. When Borzolani gave up a hit by pitch, a stolen base, and a walk in the sixth, he's given up a leadoff double in the seventh. Now 2-0 to Foligno when he takes a strike. With Jose Reyes waiting on deck. Borzolani with a 2-1, and it's off the corner. 3-1 to Foligno. Henry Rodriguez, the fireballing and sometimes erratic right-hander, up in the Nationals bullpen.
Well, he hasn't been erratic of late against the Mets. He's been spot on.
Foligno, who rarely walks, takes a rep and hits it out to right field. That'll move the runner as Worth makes the catch. Turner tags and heads for third. And arrives safely. So a productive out for Foligno. Getting Turner over to third with one out. A chance for Reyes to get the first run home for New York.
Well, you got to pick him up here.
Well, it's a perfect RBI chance for Reyes with the infield back. Probably prefer the infield in.
Well, the only problem you have here is the X factor, the center fielder Ankiel.
Of course, you don't have Tolley at third base. It's Turner. He's got a little better wheels. Reyes 1 for 3 tonight. And with that, has maintained his batting average at 333. Ryan Braun has had just one at bat tonight, 0 for 1 at 329. As the National League batting race heads into its final 2 weeks.
They look around that outfield. Keith Morse is a converted infielder, converted shortstop, first baseman. Not a great arm. Hank Hill, the best arm in the league by far. And Worth, we've seen him, an accurate, strong arm in right field, although a little bit more erratic than Hank Hill's.
Worth, the only guy who hasn't been converted. Fastball inside. Got Morse, who started his career as a shortstop. And you got Ankiel, who started his career as a pitcher. Tim Burdick joins Miguel Batista in the Mets bullpen. Now Borzolani behind on Reyes 2-0 with Tejada on deck. And Jose pops one foul. That foul ball, that fastball in on him, and it's 2-2. Reyes had three hits last night. Took one the other way for a base hit, batting left-handed in the fifth. Now batting right-handed for the first time tonight. 2-2 from Grozzolani, and the breaking ball wide, 3-2. In addition to leading the league in hitting, Reyes is in the top 10 of the league in on-base percentage, which, you know, going into the year, that was as big a knock as there was on Jose, that his on-base percentage was not as high as it should be. It's at career high levels. Slams this one foul.
Well, coming into this game, he was batting .333, Gary. There was a time in his career that you would want his on-base percentage to be .333, and it has been.
He's been in the low 350s a couple of times in his career, but .376 starting this night, good for 10th in the league.
It's going to be the second time in his career that he's hit 300.
Again, the 3-2, and he popped it up. Coming in toward the mound is Desmond to call. Two out. So Reyes can't get the run in from third.
Off-speed pitch run?
I thought it was a fastball.
No, it was changeup.
Changeup. Yeah, not in front.
Yep. Reaching. Yep, they told him.
Well, that knocks him down to 332, 1-for-4 on the night. And here's Tejada, who had the first man hit, a single up the middle in the fourth, trying to pick up Turner from third base with two out. Off the end of the bat on the changeup.
And then the Mets have left seven men on base thus far in this game. But you hate to leave a runner on third base less than two outs, boy. You hate to leave him there.
Well, that's really been the story of this homestand, hasn't it?
Well, they had a runner at third with one out in the fourth inning. But Pagan and Satin left him there. And now again in the seventh. In the Sunday night game against the Cubs, the Mets had the bases loaded three times, never scored, including one bases loaded, one out, bottom of the ninth in a tie game. Mets are 1-6 on this homestand, and five of the six losses have been by one run. So it's how you execute in those big situations that makes the difference in a one-run game.
Worth extremely shallow in right field.
How about Ankiel? Ankiel in center, my goodness. And they are playing him properly to the opposite field. Very nice. Our director, our award-winning director, Bill Webb, has got a new toy.
Well, that camera gives you a great idea how much space you have to cover in that outfield. I mean, sitting in the stands or sitting here in the broadcast booth or watching from the center field camera at home, it's very hard to understand the vastness of the outfield.
You get a feel for it there, don't you?
You sure do.
There's as much room, there's more room in back of Ankiel than in front of him.
One and two to Tejada. And Ruben fouls back the fastball. We mentioned one run games. The Mets in one run games this year are 20-24, but most tellingly in one run home games, they're 10-14. The Mets have not had a losing record in one run games at home since 1993. I mean, you have such an advantage in close games at home getting the last at bat, but the Mets have not been able to take advantage of that this year. 2-2 to Tejada. In fact, there are only four teams in the major leagues out of 30 with losing records in one-run games at home.
Ruben choking up on the bat. Like it.
2-2 from Grozzolani. And right at the second baseman, Espinosa. And so the Mets Get a leadoff double from Turner. Can't score him. Keeps it a 2-0 game as we head to the eighth at Citi Field. Most batting titles in Major League history had to be Ty Cobb, right?
Tyrus, right? There we go.
Now, what does that mean? 11 undisputed.
That's true. Isn't it, didn't you guys name that he had? You were talking about the teammate he had, Pete, that he never talked to again. That
Harry Howland.
Harry Howland, but it was not disputed.
Here's the story. At the start of the final day of the 1910 season, Cobb had a slim lead for the batting title, a few points ahead of Cleveland's Napoleon Lajoie. Cobb did not play in the last two games of the season, but Lajoie played, and because Cobb didn't have a plate appearance, his batting average didn't change. He finished at 3.8507. Lajoie hit safely 8 times in the Indians' doubleheader and finished at 3.84.
Go on.
Basically, the St. Louis Browns allowed Lajoie to bunt for any hit that he wanted.
Oh, wow.
By playing the third baseman on the outfield grass. His last at bat resulted in a wild throw to first base, which was scored an error. Otherwise, Lajoie would have won the batting title.
I wonder. Well, shoot, that's kind of surprising that Cobb sat on it. Why did he sit? Were you hurt?
Because he wasn't Ted Williams.
Is that right?
Hank Hill retired on the 3-1 put out, one out in the eighth.
Teddy Ballgame, who went 6 for 8 in that doubleheader to get to 406.
So Cobb won 12 batting titles, including that one.
Well, you know this. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Gary.
I was just going to say, second on the list, two guys had 8 batting titles, Honus Wagner and Tony Gwynn. And there you see Rogers Hornsby, Stan Musial, Rod Carew, each with 7.
Well, that Harry Heilman, when he won a batting title, I don't know which year, and maybe Dave can look it up. And the story that I read about him, he had to play a doubleheader the last day, and he went like 3 for 4 in the first game and pretty much iced it. And he played the second game. The manager asked him if he wanted to sit out. He said, no, I'm playing. And he got a couple hits and he earned it.
Did he beat out Cobb?
I'm not sure if that was the year.
Well, what strikes me about the story about Cobb and Lajoie going down on the last day is I'm assuming that the Browns allowed Lajoie to get as many hits as he wanted because everybody despised Cobb.
That's right.
Miguel Batista made 3 starts for the Mets, now his first relief outing. He has certainly worked in every conceivable role in his career.
26 relief appearances on the year, 25, of course, for the Cardinals, first one for the Mets.
40 years old. Made his big league debut in 1992. And he walked Zimmerman on four pitches. One out base runner for the Nationals. Let's check in with the studio. Kevin Burkhardt with the New York State Smokers Quit Line Game Break. Well, the Mets will be injecting themselves into a race on the road trip because they're going to Atlanta and St. Louis, and that National League wild card is still alive. Both teams won today. Braves are 4.5 in front. But the only race that they're directly involved in is Reyes's race for the batting title. Morris hits a slow ground ball. Wright comes in and off the bag Satin to make the tag for the second out as Zimmerman goes to second. So two out of the inning. See Justin Turner, who stayed in the game at second base. Josh Stinson is up in the Mets bullpen. So Turner stayed in at second. Polino stayed in to catch. So Bautista is hitting in the number two spot in the order. The Rays blew another chance today. The Red Sox lost this afternoon, beaten by Toronto 5-4, and the Rays lost again in Baltimore 6-2, beaten by Jeremy Guthrie, who improved to 8-17.
Maybe looking ahead a little bit.
Got the four-game series starting with the Red Sox tomorrow, and looks like Josh Beckett's going to pitch in that series with the sprained ankle. So the Boston Red Sox will go into that series four games in front of Tampa Bay, meaning the Rays need to sweep to get even. Worth is 1-for-3, drove in a run with a third inning single. Ball and a strike. The other hot race is in the American League West, where Texas is trying to stave off Anaheim, and the Rangers are blowing out Cleveland tonight 9-1 in the eighth. The Angels won earlier today. Jeff Weaver won his 17th. Reyes gets a nice easy hop and throws out Worth to end the inning. Three ground ball outs for Miguel Bautista to keep it a 2-0 game in the middle of the eighth. Cardinals wrap up their four-game series with a day game. Chris Schwinden makes his second big league start. 12:30 the coverage tomorrow right here on SNY. Schwinden looking for a little better than he gotten his first start. Lefty Tom Malone, who impressed more with his bat than with his pitching against the Mets at his first major league start, will go for the Nats. So a couple of September call-ups going head to head. Roger Bernardina will take over in left field. He'll bat ninth, and the new pitcher Tyler Clifford will bat fourth for the Nats.
Well, his numbers were almost, dare I say, historic. 44 hits and 80 innings pitched, 94 punch outs, 24 walks. Last year he had a lot of wins also. 3-0 though, perfect this season.
It'll be due to Ryan and Pagan, 3, 4, and 5 in the Mets batting order. In the bottom of the eighth, the Mets have been limited to 4 hits tonight. But they've twice had a runner at third with less than 2 out and been unable to bring him in. The Nationals with a couple of 2 out hits in the third to take advantage of an error and score a couple of unearned runs, and that's been it. Manny Acosta and Josh Stinson both up in the Mets bullpen. And Clifford misses high with his first fastball, 1-0. Due to 0-for-2, he's flied out, walked and popped up. Tom Gorzolani got through 2 difficult innings, the 6th and 7th, allowed no runs, 2 hits, fanned a couple. Clifford with that changeup, and it's 2-0. So Brad Peacock looking for his first win, went 5, asked for 12 outs from his bullpen. They've gotten 6 of them. Man, another good changeup, boy. That's a nasty pitch.
2-0 changeup with a 2-0 lead. Can't be looking for it, and it's a perfect pitch on the knees. Maybe that's how you're. Perfect, almost perfect year that Clippers have.
Oh, and another one.
Jeez.
Well, when it's that good, why not?
Now he's going to throw high gas.
Tom Clifford with the Brendan Donnelly sports glasses.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's a 2002 team world champion.
Time is asked for. Looking at something out of the outfield.
Baseball came over the fence. Someone just a bit outside.
And Henry Rodriguez unable to catch that in the bullpen. That goes in there.
And you have given an assist on that error.
That's true, because the throw was on target.
Staying with the changeup.
We all learned together. And he got him.
Wow.
Well, that was impressive by Clifford. Fell behind 2-0 through 3 changeups in a row to strike out Duda.
Well, it's pretty apparent in all 4 at bats with Lucas today, they have thrown him nothing but off speed and breaking stuff.
So 1 out and nobody on. David Wright coming up. Let's check in with Chris Carlin.
Guys, you know, I went to talk to Alex Cora yesterday about Clifford, and having faced him last year and played with him this year, he said, yeah, the changeup sets up everything. He said the other pitch that is just unhittable from Clifford is the high fastball. He said when he elevates it and gets it up in the zone, you cannot touch it, especially when he's throwing that changeup as effectively as he has. Now, back in the spring, he was getting beat up a little bit, and he actually went to Cora and asked him what he saw. Fastball was down in the zone, was getting hit hard all over the place. Clifford is looking to keep it up in the zone all night.
Interesting little cutter slider or something.
That slide ball.
He has all 4 pitches. Remember, he started his career as a starter. Pitched an amazing game across the street here in Shea Stadium.
Slider.
Second game with doubleheader. He's got all the pitches, knows how to pitch. I think what Chris was alluding to is that he changes eye levels better than anyone. Fastball up in the zone, breaking pitches down in the zone.
1-1 to right, and he chases that slider away, 1-2.
Well, we've seen David do this a lot, Gron.
Not seeing that slider the last couple of days.
Clifford ahead 1-2, and he throws a breaking ball in for a strike 3 call. That was just unfair.
Well,
I mean, he's a relief pitcher who throws four pitches like a starter.
Well, he wants his grip, gets those two fingers together, gets on top of that baseball. Think about Clifford. He has those long arms. It takes him a while to catch up, but once he does, that ball starts right at the letters and bends right in there for a strike.
So back-to-back strikeouts for Clipper to start the last of the eighth, and now Angel Pagan is 0 for 3. Struck out his last two at-bats. Tries to drop down a bunt, but fouls it off.
You have to say that Clipper in the National League probably having the best setup year of anyone. And probably Robertson for the Yankees might be having the best setup here in the American League, just off the planet.
The only other guy in the National League who can compare with Clifford would be Johnny Bench.
Yeah. We only need a right-handed and a left-handed.
There you go. Well, between Clifford's changeup and Venter's sinker, he got some almost unhittable pitches. 1-1 to Pagan. I tell you, was having an amazing year as a setup guy before he got traded to the American League was Mike Adams.
Yeah,
with the Padres.
He's done all right in Texas, not as dominating as he was in San Diego.
Right. But certainly gives the Rangers a much deeper bullpen now as they try and make it to the postseason. Good fastball by Clipper, 1-2.
Well, one of the rare pitchers. He's got four pitches he could use for Keith. Fastball up, change up down like he threw to Duda. Throw that big hook he threw to David Wright.
Randy Acosta getting ready for the ninth. And the 1-2 fastball popped up. Espinosa calls. Side retired. 1-2-3 inning for Clifford with a couple of strikeouts. On to the ninth. 2-0 Nats. Holding the torch. Josh Stinson will pitch the top of the ninth for New York.
Well, Stinson has really only had one uneven outing, and that was in that extra inning game on September 11th against the Cubs. Other than that, it's been pretty strong for Josh.
Pitched in the opening game of the series on Monday night. Got two outs, gave up a hit to Worth. He'll face Espinosa leading off in the top of the ninth with The Nats up 2-0. Espinosa, a bunt single his last time up, 1-for-3 on the night. Espinosa is still looking for that 20th home run that would tie a franchise rookie record. Through Storen. Getting ready in the Nationals bullpen. Brad Wilkerson set that record with the Expos. And then Ryan Zimmerman tied it with the Nationals. 20 home runs in their rookie season.
Also, isn't he tied with Freddie Freeman for the rookie lead right now at 19, I believe. So
he hasn't had nearly the year Freeman has had because Espinosa's hit 231.
Sometimes it's a catch 22 for young hitters, isn't it? He's got tons of pop, and sometimes that makes you fall into bad habits because you want to hit the ball at the ballpark.
Well, we mentioned it before, the possibility that Espinosa could be a shortstop, and you know, he becomes a much more valuable commodity if he's a shortstop who can hit 20, 25 home runs a year. Or who knows, maybe even more as he matures. I mean, you've got, you know, a few second basemen with that kind of power, but not all that many shortstops. Strike three called, so Stinson gets him looking at a slider. One out and nobody on. Let's check in with the studio, see what's coming up on Lincoln Postgame Live. Kevin Burkhardt and Bobby Ojeda standing by, guys. All right, Kev, and you know, we were nice enough to lend you to the studio for 3 days, but we want you back. Chris Carlin's done a fantastic job filling in here as Winthorpe and Valentine have traded places for 3 days. But Kevin will be back at the ballpark tomorrow. Chris Barrera 2-for-3 tonight. He takes it wide, 1-1. Barrera twice a single to center, and then he flied out to center. So he has indicated his favorite part of the field tonight. Ooh. 1-2 to Barrera. Now, Keith, we don't see you again until the last week of the season.
Right. I am got tomorrow off, and they're. It was all scheduled. I don't have the road trip.
You're just doing home games now. Is that
no? Actually, I don't know how how it worked out percentage wise, home and away. But that being said, I did my 105.
Strike three call. Stinson with back to back strikeouts.
I fulfilled my contract.
You made it sound like a sentence.
I mean, really? I thought you liked coming to work.
It sounded like I was doing my time.
So two out and nobody on. Now Jesus Flores, who hit that pop fly that Tejada made the sliding grab on and turned it into a double play back in the fourth. Flores 0-for-3. Stinson looking for a clean inning. This is low and away, ball one.
You know, it's going to be an interesting series though against Philadelphia, because you say to yourself, you know, well, they're going to have a clinch. What do they need to do here? Well, they're going to have to use all of their good starters and get them work to get them ready. And I would be very surprised if Halliday doesn't throw the last game.
Of course, this year the season doesn't end on a Sunday.
Yeah.
It ends on a Wednesday. So if Halliday were to pitch Sunday against the Mets, that would set him up for his opening start in the postseason.
That's right.
Stinson and Flores takes low and away. The interesting part is for Halliday, you know, used to going 8 or 9 innings. Will they stop at 5?
Oh yeah, it'll be you know, a 5-6 inning effort. You just don't know with Halliday. He has those games where he throws 60-70 pitches in 7 innings.
Another one to center field off the bat of Flores, and Pagan's got it. Stinson has a 1-2-3 inning. Now Drew Storen on to try and save it for the Nats in the bottom of the ninth. Well, it looks like traffic's moving nicely on the Whitestone Expressway. Always a good thing.
That's good for me.
It's my route, too.
Really?
Well, the Mets hope not to get there for a while. Down 2-0 in the bottom of the ninth. We'll look to register against Drew Storen, who's been busy in this series.
Yeah, two saves in the series, and he has been so impressive. The slider in last night's ball game was as good as you're going to see from a closer. Only number the allowed home runs. 8 home runs he's allowed this season.
Gave up a couple of hits last night with 2 outs to Reyes and Tejada. Mets got the tying run to third with 2 out, but he struck out Duda on 3 pitches to end the game. So Storen right back out there tonight looking for his 37th save. Bay, Satin, and Turner are the 3 scheduled hitters. Bay will lead off, but Willie Harris has come out on deck to bat for Satin. Jason tonight has an infield hit and a walk, 1-for-2. Mets have been shut out 7 times this year. The Nationals pitching staff has thrown 7 shutouts. Brad Peacock went the first 5. He's in line for his first big league win. Gorzolani for 2, and Clippard pitched the 8th, and now Storen in the 9th. The fastball taken high by Bay. The first night of the series, Storen walked the first man he faced, David Wright. There's Harris on deck, and then retired the next 3.
Oh boy, that's a fastball blown right by him. Jeez.
Slider to Bay, 2-1.
Two-run lead. It's got to be a fastball here, 2-1.
Wants it in.
And now he's behind, 3-1.
Here, hit it. There's a fastball.
I would opt to be keep that ball away, though, wouldn't you, Keith? Throw a fastball away, try to keep it in the big part of the park.
Well, he can't beat you. And he's not going to fool anybody.
Yeah.
Telling your pitcher to shake off signs.
3-1 to Bay, and he throws it by him, 3-2.
Cannot throw a 3-2 slider here.
Nope.
Mr. Flores just put down the fastball. Very good.
He's thrown 2 fastballs by Bay already in this at bat. This is one he misses with, and the Mets have life in the ninth. So for the second time in 3 outings in this series, Storen walks the first man he faces.
Well, the job of that leadoff hitter when you're 2 down is somehow, some way, find your way to first base. Jason did.
So now Willie Harris will bat for Josh Satin, who had a rough night at the plate. Satin went 0-for-3, struck out twice, and left 5 men on base. Harris has been swinging the bat very well lately. Got the start in left field last night and went 1-for-3. Mets have had just 4 hits tonight. They've got the tying run at the plate. Here are the recent numbers for Harris. 8-for-23 over those last 18 games. First pitch swinging, and he grounds it just foul. Had it been fair, Marrero was right on the line.
Well, we saw Harris in last night's ball game almost hit a ball out of the ballpark off Chimin Wong on a 3-0 count here. Very aggressive as a pinch hitter.
Well, Harris, Marrero's got to get a little closer to the line. He's not real agile and quick. That ball might have got by him, and he's not pushing back. He's playing behind the runner, but you got to move back with the pitch.
High breaking ball to Harris, 1-1.
Well, there's the Cholula hot sauce. It's a huge wooden cap there.
It's the iconic wooden cap. Don't you forget it. Now the 1-1. And Harris lays off. It's 2-1. Justin Turner is hitting eighth in the order. He's on deck. Ronnie Polino is batting ninth.
Storm looking like he was complaining about that pitch. That pitch wasn't even close.
It just looks to me like Storm, after with 3 days in a row, might be a little. Well, actually, it's not. Yeah, it is 3 days in a row for him.
Is.
Yeah, he's laboring.
We were speculating before the eighth inning. I know you said, Ronnie, maybe Clippert would pitch two innings today. He had such an easy eighth inning.
I thought he should have, to tell you the truth. I know how it works with closers, and you got to get them in, and all those rules that I think are, well, I won't say what I think they are. You have a hot pitcher in Clippert. Storen's pitched 2 days in a row. Aren't you concerned at some point that he's a young pitcher also that you got to watch?
24 years old. He was first round draft pick 2 years ago, same draft that they got Steven Strasburg, and Storen was kind of under the radar. But he has had a terrific start to his career. Now he's behind on Harris, 3-1, with Bay at first. And Willie swings through the fastball, 3-2. Still a couple of full counts for Storen to start his night.
Upstairs fastball with low ball hitter.
Three, two to Harris, and he walked him back to back walks, and the Mets have the tying runs on base. We'll bring Steve McCaddy out of the dugout. No action as yet in the Washington bullpen, so they don't seem to be concerned about the heavy workload on Storen these last three nights.
I mean, this is where you earn your money as a pitching coach. What would you say, Keith, to your pitcher who's in there with a two-run lead and walks the first two hitters?
Well, he overthrew that one.
Well, Storen only threw 12 pitches Monday. He threw only 14 pitches last night, so he didn't have a heavy workload in either one of those innings. Nonetheless,
if I had a young closer, Gary, and you're out of it, he would not throw more than 2 days in a row. Simple as that.
So the Mets have themselves a chance in the ninth inning with Justin Turner coming up. As David Johnson looks at his lineup card, Turner came up as a pinch hitter in the seventh and drilled a double to left center field. The Mets' only extra base hit of the night. Do you bunt with him?
Well, it hasn't worked, has it? With pitchers and players alike.
Well, last night, the Mets were particularly inept at bunting. So maybe Terry Collins goes a different way this time. Jason Priday has come out on deck to bat for Polino.
Play for the win.
Nationals looking for the bunt. Bay and Harris, the base runners. And Turner squares. Oh. They'll try it again.
Boy, oh boy, Storen is just all over the place. Well, I guess he's not going to pitch tomorrow, Ron.
Pretty good bet. If the Nats win tonight and take the first three games of this series, they'll be playing with house money tomorrow. And Turner takes a strike.
Wow.
He didn't think so. Dan Isonia told it. Turner thought it was wide.
It always bothers me when a pitcher's all over the place and then the umpire gives him the benefit of the doubt, and that's a ball.
What?
Put a little pine tar on your helmet, why don't you? Turner pops it up, and Storen has no other play. Another ill-fated bunt attempt by a New York Met. Amazing. Day after day, Terry Collins has watched his team be unable to sacrifice.
Well, something they did so well when they were playing well, and that's called execution, and it's been lacking. on this homestand.
So Jason Friday comes up, first and second and one out. Friday appeared as a pinch hitter last night and struck out against Storen in the ninth inning.
Friday's due for a bomb. Boy, that was almost a balk there by Drew Storen, who kind of stumbled off that mound, not stepped off it.
Both middle infielders come in and join the conversation. So switching up the sides. Sean Burnett, the lefty, up in the bullpen. Reyes is on deck, and then the pitcher's spot behind him. Friday just 3 for 22 as a pinch hitter this year. Storen starts him off with a slider.
Well, in a pinch hit, thou shalt not pass. He's looking for a fastball. Storen's got a tough breaking ball, tough one to lay off. Interesting about Storen. He seems to throw that slider better to lefties than he does to righties.
The 0-1 to Pridey, and he punches one foul, and it's 0-2. Bay and Harris both walked. Turner couldn't get the bunt down. Now it's 0-2 to Pridey. Storen has given up 8 home runs this year. Pridey hit one Sunday night against the Cubs. Now on 0-2, Friday swings and bounces one. Storen's got it. Gets the out at second. The relay not in time. And the game continues. But Storen got the important man, erasing the tying run, Harris at second base.
Nice athletic play. Nice heads up play there by Storen. Almost gets over his head. Looks to first, but knows the play is at second base. Desmond didn't really have to throw this ball to first.
Jose Reyes will get a chance.
Betcha he leads him off with a slider, Ronnie.
Reyes, who had a base hit against Storen last night, is 1 for 4 tonight.
I think he's trying to pop him with a fastball, Keith. Let's see, try to get ahead.
Tying runs on base with two out.
You're right. Yep. Oh boy.
This badly. 1-0. Pitcher spot is due up next, and Mike Baxter is out on deck to pinch hit if Reyes can keep the game alive. One oh from Storen, and it's wide. 2-0 to Reyes.
Interesting pitch there.
Changeup.
1-0 changeup. Third best pitch. You want to get beat with that?
Yeah.
Reyes, 2 hits and 3 career at bats against Storen. And Jose hits one out to center field. On comes Anquil, and he makes the diving catch to end the game. Reyes robbed of an extra base hit. They could have tied it. Rick Anquil makes another big play against the Mets, and the Nats have taken the first 3 games of this series as Storen completes the 2-0 shutout.
Well, just another game where the Mets were not able to punch in any runs, not able to hit with runners on base, and Ankiel, the Met killer on offense, and even more so on defense, catches that in the palm, two-hands it, and comes up with a big play.
How many times do you see a guy dive like that to his glove side and catch the ball with two hands?
Never. I mean, never.
And he had to, too, because he didn't have that ball cleanly in his glove.
Well, he's an athlete, and that's just making sure.
I also think that it was one of those plays that he didn't really have to dive, but he wanted to cushion it and make sure with two hands, like a wide receiver catching a pass.
Well, he's made his skipper look like a genius. He's had played him in right and in center, and he's been in the middle of everything defensively.
The Mets suffer their fifth straight loss as they manage just four hits. We'll be back to Citi Field.